Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for Pacific Neuroscience Institute in collaboration with Providence Southern California's Neuroscience Grand Rounds. We've had an impressive increase and expansion in terms of the scope and vision of the different educational offerings that we've been presenting to you. And when our guest speaker provided this thought, initially I was had a little bit of trepidation, but I think it fits with our mission of expanding all realms of neuroscience education, which is one of the benefits of this Grand Rounds, I would say. So without further ado, Dr. Phil Taussky serves as the co-director of the Brain Aneurysm Institute and is the surgical co-director of the Comprehensive Stroke Center at Beth Israel Deaconess Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. He received his medical degree at the University of Basel in Switzerland, and he completed his neurosurgery residency at Kantonsspital Aarau, the largest county hospital in all of Switzerland, which is internationally renowned for its busy neurosurgery service with its strong cerebrovascular and trauma foundations. Dr. Taussky completed a skull-based and cerebrovascular fellowship at the University of Utah, and an endovascular fellowship at the Mayo Clinic. He was then recruited back to the University of Utah while I was a resident there, as was Dr. Guan, where he served as the section chief of neurovascular surgery until about a couple of months ago. Dr. Taussky's practice is focused on surgical and endovascular treatment of cerebrovascular diseases of both the brain and spinal cord, and he's a particular interest in the treatment of intracranial aneurysms, arteriovenous malformations of the brain and spine. He has been a visionary in a lot of different techniques and devices in the expansion of endovascular proliferation. He was one of the high volume providers and practitioners and does a lot of education on novel endovascular techniques, as well as the management of acute and complication analysis and prevention. From a research perspective, he serves on the editorial board of the Journal of Neurosurgery, which for neurosurgeons is the largest and most respected of the neurosurgical publications. I'm so excited that Phil has agreed to join us today with a very eclectic and interesting topic. He's been a huge mentor to me and served a large role in my medical training. So I think this talk is going to be especially interesting. With that, Phil, thank you so much. And the floor is yours.
No, thank you for these kind words and introduction. I'm humbled by the thoughtful ease into this talk. The talk is maybe a little unusual, but I didn't want to I thought it's something that maybe in medicine we need to open our eyes a little bit to, and it really relates to teaching and training. And of course, in my particular background, surgical training. So this is, what can Uncle Tony teach us about surgical training? And when we talk about Uncle Tony, I need to make this disclosure first. And Dr. Guan and Dr. Sivakumar know this very well, but my main disclosure in relation to this talk is that I have a particular affinity to Roger Federer because we share the same hometown. And it's a small place, right? It's 120,000 inhabitants, and there's only one real tennis club. And it's a small tennis club. It has a few courts. And I remember Roger Federer as a junior, and I remember him saying, you know, I want to go pro, and me thinking, it's so stupid, you can be number 100 in the world or 150 in the world. I never thought that he was going to be anything more than that, and I for sure never envisioned him becoming, you know, number one in the world, one of the greatest tennis players of all time. But I think it also teaches us that we are really poor in predicting success and predicting people who are going to do well. We see the same with the NFL combine, with the NBA combine. It's very hard to predict. But I think the other thing that we're not so good at is understanding what does it actually take to become Roger Federer, Rafael Nadal, and what are the lessons learned along the way? And so this is Uncle Toni Nadal, who's a first degree uncle of Rafael Nadal, and who is the most decorated tennis coach in history with 17 Grand Slams to his name with Rafael Nadal. And he's a very unique character. It's not only sort of like a hobby of mine to talk about Uncle Toni. He just recently, a few weeks ago, gave a big talk to an international association of teachers. And he speaks to them with his background as a tennis coach, because I think I'm not the only one who thinks that he's onto something. He has a deeper insight that we need to share in an interdisciplinary way. It doesn't just relate to tennis or to medicine, but also to teaching elementary school, high school, teaching in general. So he's a very eclectic figure. And he's teaching now at Rafael Nadal has his own tennis academy in Mallorca. And they asked him to put up a couple of stimulating or motivating slogans. And this is one of the slogans that he came up with: never an excuse made us win a match, which is sort of his mantra overall. But it makes you wonder if this is motivating or demotivating overall. But I want to get into what stands behind this mindset overall, this idea of an excuse is never going to make us win a match. Just to give you a background about his training methods, he's worked with Rafael Nadal ever since Rafael Nadal is a small kid, 5-6 years old. And he had a very peculiar way of bringing Rafael Nadal up. He would play with bad balls. He would play in bad courts. He would play without water. He would say, we're going to play for 2 hours. And then he would go on indefinitely and he wouldn't announce how much longer they have to go. And it wasn't really because he's a cruel or capricious person. It was really part of a deep mindset that this is what it takes to prepare for the hardships of the tour. And he introduced this no excuses mindset, saying, you know, when you play on the tour and you want to succeed, you need to be prepared also playing with bad balls or bad courts. Or what if you don't have no water, but what if you don't have the drink that you want or that you need and no one can get it to you? And the other thing, of course, is if you go into a tennis match, it's not 2 hours, it may also be 5 hours, and you don't know ahead of time. So his mindset was not only about tennis, it was really about developing the character of Rafael Nadal with these hardships and this no excuses mindset. And there's a couple of sort of smaller anecdotes or background stories that I want to bring up, I think, that sort of illuminate or illustrate this mindset much better. Early on, when Nadal was a teenager, he was playing a match and he lost 6-0 in the first set because he had a broken racket. His racket was broken. And anyone who ever played with a broken racket, you cannot control the ball at all. And Uncle Toni pulls Rafael Nadal aside afterwards and he says, you know, I just don't understand. You know, you're losing this match, you're playing with a broken racket. How come a guy with your experience doesn't know this when his own racket is broken? And Rafael Nadal said, you know, I'm so used to taking the blame for everything, it never even crossed my mind that this may be due to a broken racket. So it's sort of this idea of no excuses mindset taken ad absurdum, where even if your racket is broken, you think it's your fault and you don't even think about anything more than that. And another one of these episodes relates to Rafael Nadal really losing early on in the Australian Open. And Uncle Toni again pulls him aside and says, you know, how come you played so poorly? And Rafael Nadal says, you know, it was just really too hot. It was just too hot. And Rafael said, Uncle Tony says, it's very funny. It only seemed to be too hot on half the court because your opponent actually played very well. So again, it illustrates this mindset of taking responsibility for everything that happens, being able to deal with everything, but also sort of a zero tolerance for excuses or ways of softening the blow. The other thing that I want to bring up that I think is an interesting aspect is that Uncle Tony was never paid as a coach on the tour. So he trained Rafael Nadal, but he never took any money for that. And he speaks about that. He speaks about the importance of being an impartial teacher and coach. And I think it relates to the fact that, you know, when you're being paid by the player that you coach, there is a conflict of interest that is unbridgeable to the extent that you don't want to get fired because it's your livelihood. And so there may be things that you need to bring up that you don't want to bring up because it may cost you your job. But these very things may prevent you from being a very effective teacher or coach. And I thought about that a lot, about the problem with that, as we all know, that when we're up for promotion in academic medical centers, if you're going from assistant to associate or associate to full professors, you're being evaluated by your trainees. And that's always on the back of your mind. And in any residency program, you know, you see here resident evaluation of faculty. You're being evaluated as a faculty member, as a teacher or a coach, as a mentor from the very people that you train with, which is very much in opposition, I would say, to this idea of impartiality as a teacher and coach, as Uncle Tony at least practiced it in his dealings with Rafael Nadal. And then there's this very famous interaction between Uncle Tony and Rafael Nadal when Nadal was playing Federer for the first time. And Nadal says to Uncle Tony, you know, can you give me some advice here or some feedback on how to go about it? And Uncle Tony, in unimitable fashion, is just so direct. He says, you know, Federer has a better forehand than you. He has a better volley than you. He moves better than you. And for sure, he has a very different serve. So I really don't see how you can ever beat the guy unless you can find a way to play each point as it's your last. And again, I don't think that this is a cruel or capricious kind of interaction conversation. It again plays to this mindset that you need to know your weaknesses, you need to know your strength, you need to address them, you cannot have any excuses, and you need to be prepared for that. And I think all of us in the medical field, this kind of mindset rings very true. We don't choose our patient, we don't choose the complexities of our patients, being medical or surgical. And we need to have an honest understanding of our own strengths and weaknesses, when we need to get extra help, when we need to get senior leadership involved, and so on. But also this idea of every point wins, right? You need to give your best for each and every patient with what you have and what you can offer. So for me, at least, this rings very true and runs very deep. And so I want to bring up some of these mindset points from Uncle Tony. And some of them come from a TED Talk that he gave recently. Some of them come from this teacher association that he addressed very recently, where he basically was an open forum, and he just presented himself to the teachers, and they could get up and ask him any kind of question. And these are some of the things that he goes into. It was sort of an unprepared situation where it was just a Q&A without any formality to it. But I think some of the things that he says ring very true and I think are very important to us. And then in the second part, I will get to what makes Nadal so unique and his generation. But Uncle Tony speaks about, he says, you know, I always knew when we went out on the field, there's only two things that could happen. It's win or lose. And with that, he says, both are part of the game. And I never gave an exaggerated importance to victory. And I didn't give an exaggerated importance to defeat either. And I thought, wow, this is so true in medicine too. You know, you try to give your best, but also you need to understand that it's win or lose with each patient, each situation. And you need to sort of embrace the idea that you cannot give too much importance to your victory, and you need to also take your defeats in stride. And I think we surgeons understand that very well. We struggle with that. But I think the idea of you need to accept the outcomes as part of your endeavor is a very important one. And then he speaks a lot, and there's of course a lot of questions from the teachers and so on. You know, what does it, how much talent is innate? How much does talent play a role? How much talent do you need in order to succeed? These kind of questions. And he comes up with this idea that talent is actually your ability to learn in life. It is not your ability, but the ability and the enjoyment to learn. And we see that in many of the sports people. We see that in Kobe Bryant, right, who would get up at 3 or 4 a.m. and have his first practice. It's that enjoyment of practicing, of deliberate practice, of getting better. And he speaks about the idea of life having a common denominator. And by that he means, and I heard that Warren Selman talked about similar aspects at the CNS conference that's going on right now in San Francisco. I haven't heard, but I didn't hear the speech, but I heard about it. This idea that, you know, you can't just play tennis well. You need to do everything you do well. And it starts with the small things in life and it goes to the bigger things. And that is meant as the common denominator. He speaks about the idea that successful people are willing to give themselves more chances of not giving up, of going out there again, of trying again, of creating more and more opportunities for themselves, which he sees as a very important part of succeeding. And then he talks about his mindset that improvement is always necessary and improvement is always possible, and how Rafael Nadal now plays very different than he played when he was 18 years old. And of course he plays better than most anyone or anyone, but how he communicated that to Rafael Nadal, that every time you go on the court you need to get better. But it's not only that you need to get better, it is possible to get better, and that's what you need to strive for. And then finally, this idea that your overall end result is this combination of talent plus work. And, you know, the less talented you are, the more work you need to put in, or the more talented you are, the less work you need to put in. But he sees that overall success or end result as this sum of these two aspects. So he completely sort of rejects this idea that people are just innate. He speaks about some people just being innately better than others, like probably Federer, who had a very unique capacity in tennis, or Messi is another one that he mentions by name. But for most everyone, it's really that combination of talent plus work. And the less talented, the more work, and so on. And he mentions this idea by Picasso, who said, when inspiration strikes me, let it find me working, meaning, you know, it's really about the work. And this sense that we lack as a society somewhat the endurance capacity, the idea that you need to go hard at it, you need to keep going, and you need to keep trying, and you may not always have this immediate success. And an overall lack of concentration is what holds us back. And I think that's a big general problem that we see in trainees no matter what your field or your background or your specialty is, it's very hard to concentrate nowadays with all the distractions. You know, I tell my kids that when I grew up in Switzerland, we didn't have cable and TV only started at 4 p.m. because there was no programming before p.m. And then we only had five channels or so. And they think it's the funniest thing they ever heard. But it's just unthinkable nowadays. And so it's also so much harder to concentrate as a result. But Uncle Tony takes this mindset to a further, to sort of a further level that I want to get into in this talk. And he talks about the big three or the big four. And he says, you know, what is so special and unique about them? And what can we learn from that? And what he tries to put it in an overall context. And I just want to put that here. If you look at the first Grand Slam won at their age, you know, Federer actually was the oldest at 21, and Nadal was 19 at Roland Garros. Djokovic was 20. So that's the age at which they won their first Grand Slam. But look at the age of competitors. So when Nadal broke into the circus, into the ATP circus, the people he was playing against, Lloyd Hewitt was 21, Roddick was 20, Federer was 22, Correa was 21, Nalbandian was 21, Ferrer was 23, and Safin, Marat Safin, was already on his way out at 24 years old. Now, if you're a competitor now and you're trying to break in, and this is the famous next gen, and of course, Carlos just proved us wrong with this recently, but if you want to break into the top 10 or the top tier of tennis nowadays, this is the age of your competitors. Nadal is 36, Djokovic 35, Federer 41, he just retired, but you know, until recently, Medvedev, who was, you know, supposed to be an next-gen guy, 26, team is 29 already. He was considered the next generation, the next great tennis player, and now he's already an old tennis player. Cilic is 33, so really a very different situation from when Nadal entered the tour and everyone was in their very, very early 20s. And you know, Kyrgios, already 27, played in the finals now, is not a young guy anymore either. If you look at the age of retirement, the previous generation, if you look at Becker, he was 31. Borg retired very early at 25. Sampras was 31. Lendl was 32. Edberg was 30. There's one exception, of course, Jimmy Connors, who was 41. But it was always sort of accepted that after 30, you cannot play tennis anymore at a very high level. It's just too much wear and tear on your body. The demands of the game, the athleticism that goes into it, is just too high for you to be able to sustain that into your 30s. And that's why the previous generation, they sort of became not irrelevant, but they really went, they really declined once they hit their late 20s, so that by the time they were in their early 30s or 30, all of them retired. So you see a very, very big change from the previous generation to the current generation. And if you look at the big four, basically the big three or the big four, they won every one of the Grand Slams for the last 16 years, with just a few exceptions. Basically, Stan Wawrinka won three, Juan Martin Del Potro won one, and Cilic won US Open, and Thiem won the US Open. All the other Grand Slams in this amazing interval of time from 2005 to 2022 were won by the big three or big four, if you take Murray into that. And just an amazing dominance. So if you look at it, by February 2022, Federer, Djokovic, Nadal, Murray had combined to hold the number one ranking for almost 1,000 consecutive weeks, or just under 18 years. In the past, if you take 18 years, that used to be three or four generations of players that may have come and gone. And in that same time, you had these three, four tennis players that just dominated. And so there's a bigger question here that Uncle Toni asks, and that basically relates to what made that generation so unique. And there's some people who try to come up with, you know, things like they were just the greatest players who ever played and they happened to be within the same generation, you know, which is not very likely because you saw the previous generation with Becker, Connors, McEnroe, Edberg, Lendl, Michael Chang. It was an incredible generation. Pete Sampras that entered, Borg early on in that generation. So what made that generation so unique, or how come they could be at the top for so long with none of the younger people taking over? And this is the next generation. And one of the interesting things that really not part of this topic, but you see Novak Djokovic is 6'2", and he's actually by far the shortest in this group of next generation. Modern tennis has produced these really, really tall tennis players. You see Tsitsipas is like 6'4", and Medvedev, and Tsitsipas is 6'4", and Matteo Berrettini there is like 6'4", 6'5". Misha Zverev is 6'4", 6'5". So modern tennis has really created this very tall tennis phenotype, which never was the case before that. But some of these aspects, Uncle Toni in a recent TED Talk addresses basically how come the next generation of these really tall players who have these huge serves, huge forehands, have not managed to push the big three or big four aside. And he's not the only one who's raised that question, and many lovers of tennis and other interests, and also people at the sidelines bring that up. And he has some answers to that, I think, that relate to our field of medicine. And he says the current generation was reared on modern technologies, the next gen of tennis players. He talks about early specialization. Nadal played soccer at a very high level before he actually specialized into tennis. And the same with Federer, played soccer at a very high level. I know Boris Becker played soccer at a very high level before he focused on tennis. So he says, the next generation of tennis players, how come they're not replacing the older generation, even though they have all these modern things going for themselves? They have early specialization. They have sports psychologists, they have nutritionists, they have physical therapists, they have very sophisticated conditioning, they have artificial intelligence. I don't know who's ever seen that, but you find that on some of the tennis courts. They have swing vision and so on. It's a camera that measures the speed and the top spin on your balls and gives you feedback on how hard you're hitting, how fast you're hitting, how many spins you have on your ball, and it gives you direct feedback. So he says, how come none of these modern technologies have resulted in a change in generation? And he speaks about the importance for that to happen, about this no excuses mindset, accepting reality. He speaks about this positive messages that you give nowadays all the time, trophy mentality that we speak about. And he says, you know, it's much better actually to know I'm not good enough. Where do I need to do better, to have self-criticism for growth? Without it, there's really no growth. And this idea again of never an excuse made us win a match. So why does it take so much for the new ones to replace the old ones nowadays? And Uncle Toni has an answer for that. And he speaks about the idea that the next generation, that generation that was reared on modern technology, they don't understand what is essential, what actually goes into doing well and winning. he speaks about the importance of training perseverance, about respecting your opponent, about the value of just pure effort, sacrifice. And he says technologies were really never essential for any of these elements that in his mind go into being successful. Perseverance, respect, effort, and sacrifice are so far removed from artificial intelligence, sports, nutritionists, physical therapists, conditioning specialists, and so on. And he says, you know, what does it actually take to win in tennis? Why don't we talk about that for a second? And he says, what it takes is endurance, determination, insight, grit, drive, and an excitement for the game. And, you know, as you read that and think about that and hear that, you say to yourself, well, what if Uncle Tony is correct? What if that is one of the reasons, if not the main reasons, why the next generation hasn't been able to replace the older generation? What if by removing the hardships of training, we have actually made things too easy and we removed the ability to create character and the idea of resistance makes you stronger? And what if the same is true in our training programs? What if the work hour restrictions, the mid-level providers that take care of a lot of the, what we used to call scout work, the electronic medical records, the emphasis on wellness, the idea that residents can decide their own training and have input in what the training program should look like and give feedback to their own faculty. What if by removing the hardships of training, we have actually removed what it takes for our trainees to get better and to get strong and to acquire the elements that are necessary to do well and to succeed? Because what is essential in surgery, and I think it's true in all of medicine, it takes a lifelong self-study of surgical anatomy, physiology, and pathology. It's, you need to appreciate your colleagues who share your workload and your values. You need to commit yourself to reducing pain and suffering in your patients, which is really the most basic way of thinking about your mission as a physician. And an appreciation of our mentorship and patronage training system. And I want to put that forward. What if Uncle Tony is correct? What if by eliminating the hardships of training, we have robbed our trainees of the essentials, an opportunity to develop a philosophical mindset that emphasizes personal responsibility, encourages insight, avoids finding excuses and blaming others, and fosters a focus on performance? And the question is, what if Tony is correct? And here's his direct quote from him. He thinks that everything that facilitates in excess weakens because it does not force you enough. And I try to sort of formulate some of these thoughts in an editorial that was actually extremely hard to publish. I only managed to publish it in Frontiers in Surgery, where I'm the editor-in-chief, so that's what it took to get this published. And I'm not trying to advocate here, you know, to beat up the residents, to make life hard, to be cruel and capricious towards your residents, but I think it's a deeper question. What if we take away the ability to form your character along the way? What if we actually rob them of an opportunity? And I tried to formulate some of these thoughts in this editorial in Frontiers of Surgery. So I wanna wrap up here. Wally, I've known already when he was interviewing for his residency spot, and we were also blown away how well he interviewed and his mindset and his enjoyment for the field and the specialty. Jian here, who I've never seen anything other than interested and excited and a good sport here in Utah with some of our trainees at the bedside here at Beth Israel. And I want to thank everyone for the ability to bring up some of these issues, and would like to open up the floor for any questions or comments.
Bill, that was intriguing and wonderful. Thank you very much. I'll ask you as we get situated, if you guys can please put your questions. It looks like there was a lot of discussion in the chat box, which is great. But if you want, if you could go ahead and copy the specific questions into the Q&A folder, that'll be great. You know, a lot of what you said hits on a bit of a controversial tone because, you know, we have to be very careful how we put criticism out there. And with our system, and I'm looking through the participants in this talk, we're all within the Providence, Southern California region with, you know, fewer directly academic educational experiences. But how would you say this translates into your working with your younger colleagues, you know, in academic or private practice, the results of these effects of training, what that does to the doctor when they come out into independent practice for the first time, where there are fewer safeguards and checks of, you know, the quote unquote abuse? How do you get them to perform at an optimal level in this type of environment that we live in now?
Yeah, I don't think anyone is advocating for abuse, and I hope I wasn't misunderstood that, you know, I'm advocating for abuse and mistreatment. And, you know, I trained before there were workout restrictions, and I don't think it was a good educational experience that way. But I think if you say, you know, what do we need to do to prepare our trainees, irrespective of the specialty, I think we need to think deeper about what are the values that we want to give to our trainees, not milestones, not competence, not skills. But what about values? What about the essentials? Why don't we spend more time thinking, what does it take to do well as a doctor? What are the important characteristics as a doctor? And how can we teach these characteristics and form these characteristics, and also focus on developing the character of our trainees rather than just talking about milestones and skills and competences? And I think that's probably what's missing. I think that's why so many of the older generation, I think I count myself, I think everyone with gray hair or bald, Wally, I'm sorry, is in that category, is why so many people are frustrated with the current trainees, is because we miss a sense of these essential values that we don't see anymore. But, you know, we're to blame, right? We train and we need to do a better job with that.
Well, let me ask you, when you take that to the next step, the majority of the doctors in this audience right now are working with their younger colleagues, where there may be, you know, aspects or elements of these concerns that you're bringing up. So do you think there's an opportunity to sort of reinstill these values if, you know, this is all a perception thing, this was not instilled in them in training to the level that, you know, let's say our audience deems appropriate?
Oh yeah, for sure. I think, you know, learning never stops, right? And you see it, and that's also an interesting aspect. You know, how come these tennis players have coaches? You know, mm-hmm. like what are you going to tell Roger Federer how to hit a forehand? So how come they have coaches? Well, they have coaches because the learning never stops, the improvement never stops, the mentorship. There's always a need for mentorship, and there's always a need to have, you know, friends, colleagues, peers, coaches around you in medicine who can bring you along and show you and introduce you. And I think that is so important. And I think the really good programs in the country, they do have mentorship for the young faculty, for the young people who come out. And it should be available not only for doctors, it should also be available for nurses and nurse practitioners, and should also be available for administrative staff and so on.
Absolutely. I think that's probably increases the importance of the different educational tools that we put out for the providers in practice, like, you know, grand rounds, for example, and, you know, more probably importantly, the morbidity and mortality conference. You know, we don't even call it morbidity and mortality conference anymore. It's called quality review to give it a softer tone. And I think that's sort of just this indication of the progression we're in. And it restates what the importance of that is. Let me get to some of the questions here with Dr. Kalani. With the work hour limitations on residents, do you think this is a detriment to the resiliency of future MDs? And the new generations of doctors are not geared up to the reality of medicine presently.
That's a good question, right? I mean, I don't pretend to have the answer, but I think it's a good question. And it's a question that we need to ask ourselves. Are we robbing the trainees of an opportunity to develop resiliency by making it too easy? And I think that's a fair question. I think that's a question that we need to answer as a general specialty, as a field, right? The field of medicine needs to answer that question, I feel. And it may well be, right? It may well be that once you take away that resistance, that you rob them of an opportunity.
Absolutely. I think there are some good comments here by Dr. Joshi and Dr. Walensky, who have been putting some great comments in the chat. Elizabeth, can we make them able to speak? I think that'd be worthwhile coming from them as opposed to just reading it out loud.
Yes, let's see.
And can you make Dr. Ruby as well?
Yes. What was the third one, Dr. Walensky?
Joe Walensky, Archon Joshi, Ron okay. Ruby, and then Angela Chang, if they want to mention things. I think this is a better avenue for this talk this time around because it's more commentary.
Okay, there is a hand up. While I'm unmuting the others, I'm going to allow Kareem Madhavi to.
Excellent. Yeah, we can just open it. If we can open it up to everyone, I think I'd be okay with that for this talk. If you are.
Sure. I'm not sure if I can do that as a whole. I'm going to look into that. For now, Kareem Madhavi, you can unmute.
All right, Dr. Madhavi, do you have anything you'd like to say? While we're waiting for him to unmute, Dr. Joshi, would you like to share your comments there?
Sure. I mean, I heard most of this talk, and I really appreciate it because it's like some of you, I trained a generation ago, and at least at UCLA where I trained in ophthalmology, we've seen this dramatic change in sort of both the style of training with curtailed hours and so on, but also I think as a result, a generation of doctors now, and I'm finished training 25 years ago, so I speak in generational terms, that is at once more protective of their personal lives, which I think really does change the texture of what they even choose to do post-training. You know, the ability to have personal lives completely separated away from work allows them to then go into those kinds of jobs. So, you know, I think there's less of this sort of need to create your own space and be responsible for that space surgically and medically speaking in the terms of your own practices and so on. So I think it's had a huge impact. It'd be interesting to see how it plays out over the long run. But thank you for your talk. Many of the things you said, I personally agree with.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Tang, who is a former medical educator. Dr. Tang, could you comment here? This you're bringing up a very intriguing and controversial topic here.
Yeah, I appreciate the speaker's talk. It was very interesting. And I taught with a residency program for many years. It's been a little while now, but even back then we were feeling the impact of work hour restrictions and wondering very much as educators whether we were moving in the right direction. I was surprised, however, to see in the New York Times this week that this sort of approach has gotten all the way down at the undergraduate level. So I'm just kind of wondering, you know, if an NYU professor this week got fired because his organic chemistry students thought his class was too hard, what is this doing? You know, what is this doing downstream at the medical school level? And is it happening even before residency? So just a comment.
Yeah, you know, I had a I had a recent experience. I had to draw. I had to draw blood. I mean, someone had to draw my blood, and they hit the ulnar nerve, which was incredibly painful, and it lasted for a few days. And I said to the doctor in the office, I said, you know, this is so painful. And he said, you know, what do you want from me? That's just a new generation. And I thought, we may have a lot of problems coming our way. But yeah, I think we'll have to see.
It'd be very interesting to see if this, you know, this phenomenon that's going on currently in tennis plays out here. You know, from the neurosurgical realm, at least the younger attendings feel like there's a slower rate of turnover, you know, within their institutions, you know, even in private and academic practice, actually, where the more senior providers are going longer and deeper into their career. And that sort of sets a metaphorical or even a physical ceiling on the younger attending. The attrition rate for neurosurgeons in their first job is about 60 to 70% in the first 2 years, which is, you know, startling. And, you know, I even heard about things in historically stable places like our old institution, Phil, that really shocked me, you know, to that end. You know, I've been blessed to be here for, you know, going on a little over 5 years now, you know, despite this abuse that we're talking about you guys putting on our younger providers. But it is it's a tough one. Dr. Walensky, could you comment here? You put some great, great points here in the chat box.
Yeah, that was a great talk. I mean, you certainly, you know, got right to it. Don't take a point off. You know, that's a corollary of your, you know, live your life as if every day is your last. So it seems to have been somewhat derivative. And yes, I'm a tennis fan, so, you know, I've seen many a player from Ash and Smith on. So, you know, the work ethic has to be there. That's certainly analogous. And his points about, yes, technology cannot give you those basic values. You know, it seems to me that starts with your upbringing. Certainly the comment about the students getting the teacher fired because the organic chemistry was too hard is ominous, but is an example of what seems to be societal. I think you're probably hinting at that, but you know, you still, you know, if you boil it down, not everyone will have the hand-eye coordination and brain power of Roger Federer or Nadal or the others. There's a ceiling which is, you know, it's God-given. You know, intelligence, there are analogies to it, certainly. I'm a neurologist. And yes, I trained over 30 years ago, and you know, it was much tougher than it is. So when we recruit young people, you know, their sense of what is hard work is seemingly it's a generalization, but you know, it's an exception. The person who is the hard worker now, which is, you know, yeah, it's ominous for our field and medicine in general.
Hey, Wally, Ron Ruby, can you hear me?
Yeah. Can we open up Dr. Bernie Klein on there to Elizabeth while Dr. Ruby is speaking?
So I trained two generations ago, so I probably have trumped everyone thus far, no pun intended. Nevertheless, we drew our own blood, did our own blood cultures, did our own acid fast bacilli testing, Gram stained, did everything that we ordered today. And I feel like the younger generation is really missing out on some of that. I had the mindset that as an aspiring endocrinologist, not only did I want to learn my my craft, but I wanted to know more than the cardiologist, gastroenterologist, and never the neurosurgeons, but it has served me very well. And even at my ripe old age of 70s, I'm still playing competitive tennis and love the spirit that Rafa Nadal and Roger Federer bring to not only tennis, but life in general. And I think they are spectacular models of the way young doctors ought to think.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's a wonderful comment. And I want to second that. I agree. And I think it speaks to that aspect that, you know, I forgot how he presents it, but basically life has a common denominator. You can't be a top athlete without also having built your character and your mindset and your work ethic and all of these things.
Absolutely. I wanted to get a different take on this. Bernie Klein is the CEO at an incredibly successful CEO at the Providence Holy Cross Medical Centers. And so I was hoping to get your thoughts if you'd be willing to share on this as it pertains to your realm from what you see from the administration executive level.
Yeah, thank you so much for asking me to share. First off, I also trained prior to the restrictions. I think they came in not long after I finished training. And I trained at Harbor UCLA, and it wasn't unusual to work 36 straight hours with minimal rest or being in the ICU on call every other night. I think that that was actually probably dangerous. And in fact, as I look back on it, not sure I did the very best I could have done, but I do think we need to strike a balance between these crazy long shifts with no sleep and the limitations they have now. What I'm seeing is in our younger physician generation, they're much more into working their shifts, punching their clock. They're much more into work-life balance. And if they aren't, their spouse is into that. We recently have a surgeon who's actually leaving Holy Cross to try to find better life balance because his wife basically said, we didn't agree to this, you're working too many hours. So, I think it's really a matter of we need to find a better balance. We do need to put people under stress because these are stressful jobs and we got to learn how to have resilience. But on the other hand, we got to make sure that we are always keeping the patient's safety in mind. Those are my thoughts.
You know, I will say it's been a little bit one-sided here. I will speak, you know, on behalf of the younger-ish generation here. There are a lot of things that are affecting the younger and senior doctors alike that are actually getting in the way of what's important in terms of the medical practice and taking care of patients, that direct patient care. And I think that's part of what's not just burning out doctors, but changing their mindset, but not enabling them to develop that strength to focus on that. You know, when we're talking about those extra work hours and things like that back in the day and drawing labs and you know, putting in Foley's and things of that sort, which I still do, and I think are actually very important, that you were directly looking at the patient the whole time. Right now, you know, all of that time that you were spending doing that stuff directly, looking at the patient, directly related to patient care, we're sitting in front of a computer, you know, putting in notes or, you know, in 6 million administrative meetings, no offense, Dr. Klein. But I think that's an aspect of the medical practice that has changed, which may account for some of these discrepancies. I felt like I needed to support our younger generation there.
That's pretty fair. Can you guys hear me for a second?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I think there's really a lot to be said about that. What Dr. Klein just said, which is that, you know, these restrictions didn't just materialize from nothing. We really did have several significant cases where overworked residents, we're talking about 30, 35 years ago, didn't pass over care appropriately. There's been lots of litigation about this. This is how this whole sort of work restriction thing started. But as others have said, what's kind of happened as a result, at least in ophthalmology, is what used to be the calling to do something, right? It's sort of, it's your life's work, essentially. At least that's how I trained. And it remained that way. It's become this sort of work-life balance thing. There's sort of a completely, there's a change in the dimensionality of what medicine at least was about in my generation. Not everybody in my generation, but a significant number of us. And you really don't see that very much. It's very much that work-life balance that Dr. Klein was talking about, where we have residents who only want to work certain hours and will only do things for a couple of days a week. You know, there's a lot of that negotiation that goes on, which at least when I came out of training was sort of like, let's get to work. You know, how do we make this happen? How do we keep learning? And how do we care for the patient ultimately? It's changed.
Do you feel like some part of it has to do with the fact that, you know, you came into practice working for yourself? You know, this is your practice, the one that you've sort of built up on your own, versus a lot of these people who are coming out now because of the medical system, they're coming into employed positions. Because I'll tell you, that's the big part of what I see from where this discussion is. A lot of our younger colleagues are coming into these salaried positions, sure. Which overall, I will say, you know, Providence, the way they're doing things, I am a Providence, you know, adjacent employee, and I think this is overall better for patient care. But that is something that may make it harder to take that ownership.
I can't speak for the younger generation, but I think there's certainly an element of that, a significant element of that. Speaking again from just ophthalmology, when I finished training, salary jobs weren't the things that the average high-performing resident and fellow was looking for. They were looking to sort of do something that was entrepreneurial. They were able to do stuff they wanted. They were remaining in the academic world. They were teaching. They were writing. So that was sort of the dynamic. And then at least over the last 25 years, it's become much more, because I think of the dynamic of how physicians are paid and the expansion of these the HMO and hospital-based organizations, the coveted jobs are now those jobs because they provide the work-life balance. And the other part is, I think because there are not that many jobs available, or at least it takes much more effort to do it, that it doesn't happen very much. As a point in case, I don't think there's been a single ophthalmologist in the South Bay. I'm speaking of Redondo, Torrance, this area, who's come into private practice to put a shingle up in the last 15 years. Everybody that's arrived has worked for some or other HMO or for Providence and a few for THIPA. But you're exactly right. I think that dynamic has changed things a lot.
Dr. Ana Fuentes, did you want to comment? If you do, you're muted right now. Let me see a couple of other questions here. Are Dr. I think we've answered. Yes.
I think Mrs. Steltz-Lenorski has risen her hand. She wants to ask something.
Thank you so much, Dr. Taussky. Loved your talk. Two worlds of mine collided as well. I'm a tennis player and actually captain a men's USTA team. So it's been very interesting. And then I do the continuing medical education here at St. Joseph's. So one thing that strikes me about the top four is the kind of mentorship they had. And I don't think Uncle Tony gives himself enough credit for how important that was. And the fact that, you know, he was an uncle. Mary's worked with his mother. Djokovic had a very close relationship with his coach, as did Federer. And so, you know, from a young age, they had that mentoring. And I think that's so important. And I've heard that throughout my 30 years here is, you know, physicians talk about their mentor. They talk about, you know, who they studied under. And I wonder if that's something that's not really happening with both the next gen tennis players as well as the next generation of physicians.
I think that's a fantastic point, and I would love to hear what Walavan has to say about that. But I think it's very true, right? I don't know who's ever seen that clip where someone, an interviewer asks Federer about his coach and he starts crying. Mm-hmm. His coach died early during a safari in South Africa, but it's so true, right? These very deep connections and this mentorship, but it goes both ways, right? You only want to mentor people who are up for it and who want to put in the work, and you don't want to mentor people who you think are not going to take this as seriously as you are. So I think it goes both ways, but I don't know what Wally thinks.
No, I absolutely agree. I mean, it's like, the bond that people talk about with the soldiers, and then, their superiors and things like that when you go into war. And that's what residency and training and even early careerhood, actually a lot of your career feels like. And so you develop these deep bonds with these people that you're looking towards for support. You know, I feel that way with you, with the other attendings at Utah, with my partners right now. And there was a great talk. We did a young neurosurgeons reception, and one of these up and coming stars from UC San Francisco, the best neurosurgical program in the country, was talking about it and his journey. And what made his very unique is that he went person by person across the continuum of his development. And in neurosurgery, because it's such a small field, everybody knew about all of those different people. And he made it so clear how much of a specific and very nuanced impact each one of these individuals have on their lives. When you're dealing with the stress of medicine and taking care of patients, especially over the last couple of years, all of that means even more. And Dr. Tang was mentioning also, which is definitely true, it would be interesting to consider the dominant female tennis players like the Williams sisters, et cetera. I hope everybody had a chance to watch King Richard. It was an impressive piece, for sure.
For sure.
Dr. Wally, I believe that Dr. Madavi is now unmuted.
Oh, great. Hi, Dr. Madavi. Did you have anything to say?
Dr. Madavi, you've been unmuted. You can share your thoughts this time. No, maybe he's having trouble, doctor.
Okay. If there's a question, sir, you can put it in the chat box and we will get it back to you there. You know, with that, Phil, that was actually very incredibly insightful and thought-provoking, as we saw from the discussion that followed. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For everything.
Great talk, Dr. Taussky. Wonderful talk.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Great feedback. It's always good to have that. And thank you so much for getting your forms to us. We really appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you.
So there will be CME here. Thank you all for joining us for Neuroscience Grand Rounds. Have a happy, safe, productive, and resilient month. We'll be back in November, the second week, with some exciting topics. And as always, if you have anything interesting you'd want discussed, please go ahead and reach out and we'll do our best to get that topic discussed. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Phil.